property stuff is a mix of stuff. It's a mix of stuff from chapter 5 and chapter 18, 19, etc. And so what you can do is to review this, you can go back and take a look at chapter 5 and then, or jump ahead. You know, it'll be new material to the chapter on redox. But there's one other place you can get some additional information, and that is Mastering Chem. Did any of you use Mastering Chem? All right. What I'm going to be doing is I'm collecting paper homework this semester, but I also have Mastering Chem set up for this class. The Mastering Chem is not going to be worth any points. What you're going to find on Mastering Chem are all tutorial problems. And so I posted some stuff from Chem 1A, like Chapter 5 review and some other things, you know, just to do. Those are entirely optional. If you want, you can go back through and use those as a review. I also posted tutorial problems for all the other chapters as well. So let's say you're getting stuck on a particular section and you want some additional help with it. Well, one option is to go to Mastering Chem and work through the tutorial problems for that particular section. You know, some people in the past have done all of them, you know, all the tutorial problems. It does take time, but you know, if you do those, then I'll factor that in. You know, not necessarily as points, but as something like if you're borderline, I might use that to bump you up, let's say, Mastering Chem. And so take a look at the Mastering Chem course ID is on the course information sheet there, ECC Chabal Chem 1B. All right, so what we're doing is we're starting off with chemical properties and jumping up to chapter 24, just covering the first three sections, and jumping back down to 15. And then we're gonna go 15, 16, 17, 18, and then drop back down to chapter 13, which is Thermo 2, and then go up to chapter 20, and then back down to chapter 19, and then 24, and then 25. I do this, I just want to keep the sections together, certain sections together, which I like to tie in. So this is why I jump around and did. This first one is just, you'll find the information in the book, but it's all over the book, and it's not really put together in this way. But basically, this first section is dealing with chemical properties, and chemical properties are a big, important topic in Chem 1B. So we spend our time looking at chemical properties. So, looking at chemical properties. Let's look at dichromate and permanganate. All right, what is dichromate? Somebody remind me. This I didn't put on the review for Chem 1A, but you should review this from Chem 1A. That is nomenclature. What is dichromate? Cr2. Cr2O7 is correct. What's the charge?
2-.
2-, that's right. How about permanganate?
MnO4, also negative
2. MnO4, okay, also negative 2 is close, but it's not negative 2, it's negative 1. Yeah. So dichromate and permanganate. All right, obviously these are different ions, different anions. But what do these two ions have in common?
Oxygen.
Oxygen, yeah.
Oxygen. The negatively charged?
Oxygen, well, that's compositional. What chemical property do these two have in common? They both have a negative charge, so they want something positively charged, mm-hmm. perhaps. So, yeah, they're looking for cations to pair up with. What else? When I look at dichromate and permanganate, the thing that stands out is that both of these are powerful. Non-reducing agents. They're both powerful oxidizing agents. So what's the difference between an oxidizing agent and reducing agent?
Well, oxidizing agents want what?
Electrons.
But when you look at it, these are both anions. These are both anions, they have extra electrons, right?
So why would they want more electrons, you know? Does it go dichromate with a 3- charge rather than a 2- charge? Is that how it works? And we have permanganate with a 2- rather than a 1-. Is they want electrons in that way? You know, don't they already have extra electrons? Why am I wrong? These must be both powerful reducing agents. Reducing agents have electrons to give up. Oxidizing agents, reducing agents, that's stuff from chapter 5.
It's talked about a little bit in chapter 5, but mostly it's talked about in chapter 19. Chapter 19 deals with a lot of
oxidizing agent, reducing agent. So you go back to chapter 5, you look at that, but if that's not enough, go up to chapter 19. Chapter 19 starts off with batteries, but if you jump to the middle of the chapter, then it gets into the oxidizing agent, reducing agents, if you need a little bit more on that. But oxidizing agents want electrons. Why do these want electrons? Don't they already have plenty of electrons? What makes dichromate an oxidizer? All right, so there's another thing that we do, and this is something that you should review as well, and that is when we analyze something like this, you know, one of the things that we look at is a number, you know, or a state called the, when we're thinking about oxidation and reduction, we think about the oxidation state or the oxidation number. And so that's something else you need to review. Do you guys remember how to do oxidation state and oxidation number?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right, so let's do this here.
When we assign the numbers, which one do we assign first, chromium or oxygen?
Oxygen.
And what's the charge on oxygen, or the number?
-2.
So oxygen gets it. Now, do I remember the rules? I don't remember the rules. What I did is I kind of, I remember, you know,
I don't remember the step-by-step rules. What I did was I just kind of figured out just the general pattern of doing oxidation states. The general pattern of doing oxidation states is the more electronegative element gets its preferred oxidation state. So oxygen is more electronegative, it gets a -2.
And then we go with, well, if oxygen is -2, what does that make chromium? +6, that's right. Chromium gets +6. So oxygen is a -2, it's happy, but if chromium's at +6, is that kind of high, positive charge? That's a pretty high positive charge. And so what makes dichromate an oxidizer is the charge that is the oxidation state. Oxidation state is defined as the apparent charge on an atom, assuming that the bonding is 100% ionic. And so when we look at the charge on the chromium, assuming the bonding is 100% ionic, it's pretty high. It's +6. How many +6 ions do you know? None, right? And so, but is that accurate? Well, the bonding is not 100% ionic, it's covalent. The oxygens are kind of, the bonding is not quite 100% purely ionic, and it's not purely covalent, somewhere between. But anyway, here, what causes dichromate to be an oxidizer is chromium. Oxygen is very happy, and this -2 is the net charge. The net charge
Well, the net negative charge comes because one of the oxygens has those two electrons, or a couple of oxygens have an extra electron. And so that's happy as is. So it's an oxidizer. And the same thing goes with permanganate. You know, one of the first things we look at are the oxidation numbers or oxidation states. And so over here it's the same thing. What gets assigned first, manganese or oxygen?
Oxygen
minus 2, that means manganese is what?
Plus 7.
And you look at that, and that's very high. That's a very high positive charge. This is what makes these two very powerful oxidizers. That's what makes these two very dangerous. These are very dangerous chemicals, dichromate and permanganate, because they're powerful oxidizers. You know, they aren't stable.
They're very reactive. And so when I look at that, I go, wow, that's very reactive. So,
they're very reactive towards things that have electrons to give up. Now, the dichromate and permanganate both want the same thing. They want electrons. So if you have a mixture of these two, I don't have to worry too much, because both of them want electrons. Neither of them are going to give it up. But I need something that has electrons to give up. And that's where the danger part can come in. And so what I do is I call electron deficient species, like dichromate and permanganate, electron poor. And so these electron poor things want something that's electron rich. So can you think of something that's electron rich?
If these are good powerful oxidizers, what are good powerful reducers? What comes to mind? Metals. Metals are good reducers. And so I wouldn't want to mix metals with these, because that could be a dangerous reaction if I mix metals with these.
Because metals are electron rich. Not metal cations, but just metals.
Metals. Watch out. There are other things that are potentially electron rich.
For example, let's look at this. Do you recognize this?
Yeah.
What is that? CH3CH2OH. Is that a... That's ethanol. Is that a hydrocarbon? An alcohol or carboxylic acid? It's an alcohol. It's an ethanol. Is ethanol, what would you say? Is that electron rich, electron poor, or maybe neither? Rich nor poor? It's electron rich. It's electron rich. Well, so let's go ahead and do the oxidation states here. Now, the rules for oxidation states is it's usually the most electronegative gets assigned first, unless you have hydrogen or group 1. If you have hydrogen or group 1, those get assigned first. Here we have hydrogen, and hydrogen gets assigned first at what?
+1.
So each of the hydrogens is +1. And then after hydrogen goes oxygen at -2. Let's do a quick aside here. What if we had something like this? Sodium with an H. You know what we call that? NaH. This is called sodium hydride. Now, if we have a choice, it's between sodium versus hydrogen, which one gets assigned first? The metal gets assigned first. Group 1 and group 2 get assigned first. And so this is group 1. Sodium gets assigned +1 first. If sodium gets assigned +1 first, then hydrogen is? It's got to be -1, you know, because all these have to add up to 0, the net charge on the compound. So over here, over here, we'll just go back to this. That means carbon is what?
+2.
Well, let's do it here. We have 3 hydrogens of +1, so that's +3. 2 hydrogens of +1, so that's +2. +3 plus 2 is +5. Then 1 hydrogen of +1, +5 plus 1 is +6. +6 minus 2 is +4. And so that means each carbon is minus 2. And so this carbon's minus 2. This carbon should be minus 2. That's it. This is the standard way of doing it. But the standard way of doing it gives you what we call the average oxidation state. This is the average oxidation state on the carbons here. We have two carbons. It turns out that neither of them are minus 2. You know what they are? Those two carbons are different. And this is the other way we do oxidation states. The oxidation state is the charge on the atom that results if we assume that the bonding is 100% ionic. And so what we'll do is we'll draw the Lewis structure for ethanol, and then we'll assume that the bonds are 100% ionic. These are not 100% ionic. This is practically 100% covalent because the electronegativity difference is very small. But oxidation numbers are very useful. So what we do is we use them to compare for redox properties. And so even though this technically this is wrong, it's very useful for comparison because we treat everything the same. Since we treat everything the same, then we can generate these numbers, and these numbers are very useful in predicting properties. However, these numbers are different because you've heard another number, and the other number is formal charge. Do you remember formal charges? Mm-hmm. Formal charges are the opposite. Oxidation numbers assume the bond is 100% ionic. Formal charges are at the opposite extreme. At the opposite extreme, we assume the bond is 100% covalent. We assume the bond is 100% covalent, and then figure out what the charges are. And so what we should never ever do is we should never ever compare a formal charge with an oxidation state. You know, it's like comparing apple. You know, if somebody asks you what's the biggest apple, and you tell them, well, this is the biggest orange. You know, they're totally different numbers. And so we don't do that. We can compare oxidation states with oxidation states, which is fine. But in this case, this is the way I do it conceptually. Conceptually is, if this bond were ionic, then the more electronegative species would take all the electrons. So what's more electronegative, carbon or hydrogen? Carbon versus hydrogen, who wins the electrons?
Carbon.
Carbon's more electronegative. Not by much, it's only 2.4 versus 2.1 or so. But carbon takes all the electrons from hydrogen. So that gives it 2, 4, 6 electrons. Carbon versus carbon, who wins in that case? It's got to be a tie. They're equal. And so it's going to be a tie. And so now we split the electrons, and now we count them. Carbon ends up with 2, 4, 6, and one more, 7 electrons. How many valence electrons does carbon normally have? 4. So if it normally has 4 electrons, and it ends up with 7 electrons, then that means it has 3 extra negative charges. So the oxidation state on this carbon is minus 3, not minus 2. Minus 2 is wrong. Here. The hydrogens end up with no electrons, so each hydrogen is plus 1. It normally has 1 valence electron. If it loses that, then it goes plus 1. How about this carbon here? Well, this carbon is different. So carbon versus hydrogen, carbon wins. Carbon versus oxygen, who wins?
Oxygen.
And so how many electrons does carbon end up with here?
3.
Well, it ends up with actually more. 2, 4, 5. 5 electrons. So normally has 4, so it ends up with 1 extra electron, which means this carbon is minus 1. And so if we have a minus 3 carbon and a minus 1, the average is minus 2. But this method is more detailed, so we can, rather than averaging things out, we can get the oxidation states on the individual atoms. And these two are different. This carbon is more electron rich. This carbon is more electron poor. Now, rich and poor are just relative terms. Rich and poor relative to what? Well, you know, it might not be so rich, or it might not be so poor. And so there are other things we need to do. You know, what are the typical oxidation states you expect for carbon? You know, carbon's oxidation state ranges from what to what? You know, what's the maximum positive, and what's the maximum negative value for carbon?
And so this is, you should review this too, you know, from the quantum chapter. Now, carbon sits here at 4 valence electrons. So, what can carbon do? Well, carbon's kind of halfway in the shell. This is the second shell. So one thing carbon can do is it can gain 1, 2, 3, 4 electrons. If it gains 4 electrons, it'd be isoelectronic with neon and complete its octet. Right, do you guys recall that? And so carbon can go from -4, or the other option is it can lose all its valence electrons. So if it loses 1, 2, 3, 4, it'd be isoelectronic with helium, so it's lost its valence shell. And so there are two options for carbon at the extremes. At one extreme, we have +4. At the other extreme, we have -4. And so, you know, this is getting close to the -4, right? No? Here. So this is why I call this electron rich. Have you ever seen carbon in the -4 oxidation state? Do you know where it is in -4? Yeah, methane. If you look at methane, hydrogen gets assigned first. Hydrogen is +1. We have 4 of those, so that gives us +4 net charge. And then carbon is -4. And so carbon and methane is the most electron rich you can get. And so that's good. Now, one thing you don't want to do is you don't want to mix methane with dichromate. You're going to get a reaction there. In fact, that reaction can result in a fire or potentially an explosion. You don't want to mix methane with permanganate. You don't want to mix methane with what? You know, there's a very common oxidizer here. If I just left this going, we're going to fill this room up with methane. Is that dangerous?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very dangerous because methane's electron rich, and this room has lots of oxygen. Oxygen is electron poor, you know, because oxygen is O2. And O2, what's the oxidation state on oxygen in O2?
Zero.
Well, oxygen likes to be -2. And so this is why we say it's electron poor, even though it doesn't have a positive charge. It wants 2 more electrons to become O with a -2. And so the same thing with ethanol. One of the chemical properties, can you tell me a chemical property that you know for ethanol? Ethanol is very volatile, but volatility is more associated with physical properties of vapor pressure, that kind of thing. It's very flammable. Flammable would be chemical properties. Flammable is this. Ethanol is what we call a fuel, and then all we need is a oxidizer, like dichromate, like permanganate, or like oxygen. And so the most common oxidizer for this is oxygen. Well, we already have an oxygen here, but this oxygen is different than that oxygen. When I look at this oxygen, what's the oxidation state of this oxygen? And so oxygen versus carbon, oxygen wins. Oxygen versus hydrogen, oxygen wins. So oxygen is going to take all of the electrons, which means it's going to be -2. And so this oxygen is quite a bit different than that oxygen there. This oxygen is already happy as is with that octet. In a sense. Although that one does have an octet if you double bond. This hydrogen's left of none, so these hydrogens are all +1. All right, so ethanol's electron rich, oxygen's electron poor. So if I take my ethanol and react it with oxygen, what do I form? So in other words, it's flammable. So if I combust it, it's going to form CO2 and water. So
So let's look at CO2. What's the oxidation state on carbon in CO2?
Plus four.
That's right. So let me ask you this. This is called complete combustion. Can I have incomplete combustion? Can I form carbon monoxide as a potential product?
Yeah.
Yeah. If I form carbon monoxide, we don't want to form carbon monoxide because carbon monoxide is quite toxic. But if I form carbon monoxide, it hasn't been completely combusted. What is the oxidation state of carbon in carbon monoxide? Plus two. And so what can happen is carbon monoxide can be burned further to carbon dioxide. In other words, if I combust it more vigorously, I can go to carbon dioxide. Well, can I burn carbon dioxide more vigorously to carbon trioxide?
No.
So answer is no, I can't. This is not carbonate. Carbonate has a 2- charge. This is carbon trioxide. Carbon trioxide doesn't exist. We don't really factor that in as a possibility because if anybody made it, it'd be highly unstable. Why? Yeah, because carbon would be at plus six. Now, if carbon were at plus six, this is what's got to happen.
It'd be
isoelectronic.
Magnesium.
Hmm?
Be isoelectronic magnesium.
No. It'd be isoelectronic with nothing on the periodic table. Basically, if carbon were plus six, that means it's lost every single one of its electrons.
Oh, you're right.
And so not only did it lose its valence electrons, it lost its core electrons. Now, losing core electrons is very difficult because losing core electrons costs you 10 times more energy than losing a valence electron. And so it's not likely to happen. And so something like this would be, we wouldn't consider it. So complete combustion stops at plus four. And so this is why we keep in mind the range of oxidation states. The range of oxidation states of carbon ranges from minus four to plus four. How about manganese? When we look at manganese, you know, if it loses all the d electrons, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the s electrons, 5, 6, and goes all the way to plus 7, it'd be isoelectronic with argon. It's going to stop at plus 7.
Yeah.
And so in this particular case, this is it. This is the max positive oxidation state for manganese. For chromium, it's the same, plus 6. For carbon, it's plus 4. And so those types of things we keep in mind when we're looking at the properties. This is going to impact certain things. Like, for example, some things can go either way. So, for example, carbon monoxide can go either way. It could lose electrons or it could gain electrons. So carbon monoxide can be both. It can be an oxidizer, that is, take electrons, or it could be a reducer, give up electrons, because it's kind of in the middle of the range. However, carbon dioxide cannot. Carbon dioxide can only be an oxidizer. It can only be an oxidizer. Now, we need some general knowledge just to have as a reference point. Is carbon dioxide a good oxidizer? I'll tell you, dichromate and permanganate are powerful oxidizers. Would you put carbon dioxide in the same because it's plus four? Now, there we need a little bit of factual knowledge, a little bit of experience. Is CO2 a good oxidizer? No, CO2 is not. CO2 is much weaker than oxygen. In fact, they use CO2 in fire extinguishers. You know, would you use oxygen in a fire extinguisher?
No.
No, if you put pure oxygen in a fire extinguisher, you're going to be doing what's called fanning the flames. You're going to make the flame even more intense. And so CO2 is not a good oxidizer. CO2 is a weak oxidizer. So even though this is electron poor, it's not that poor. You know, we exhale CO2. We're not. We can blow out candles with our exhaled CO2. But anyway, going back to this, though, even though it's a weak oxidizer, it's still an oxidizer. And so CO2 is used in paper and wood extinguishers, but never in metal. You never use a CO2 fire extinguisher in a metal fire. Why? Yeah, if you use CO2, it's feeding the fire. You know, what you're doing is because CO2 can act as an oxidizer. Metals are good electron-rich reducers, so CO2 should never be used in a metal fire because CO2 is an oxidizer, right? But in a wood or a paper fire, it's okay because it's so weak. And so so these numbers, we try to put some meaning to the numbers, and the meaning to the numbers comes just from experience or from memorizing something here or there. It's like this, you know, ethanol is great. It's a great fuel. You can make a nice fire with ethanol. Ethanol is an alcohol. How about this? CH3COOH. Do you recognize this? Yeah, this is a carboxylic acid. And do you know which one it is? Acetic acid. Let me ask you this. You know, I know ethanol burns. Does acetic acid burn? Will acetic acid catch on fire? No? Acetic acid won't catch on fire because acids don't catch on fire? Is that the reason why, or it doesn't seem like acids catch on fire, do they? Is it flammable? Potentially, it's not great. You know, acetic acid, if you're gonna build a fire using acetic acid, it's not gonna work that great, but will it burn eventually? Yes, it will. Acetic acid burns. It doesn't have to make a fire. You can burn it in your body. You know, for example, if you drink ethanol, you know, one of the things is you could get drunk potentially, but another thing is you're gonna get calories. You know, you can get you can get a lot of calories from ethanol because ethanol is a good fuel. Good fuels have electrons that they can give up to the oxidizer. And so the same thing with vinegar. You know, vinegar is not calorie free. Vinegar is going to have calories associated with it. So you can burn it. You can burn it in your body as a fuel, or you can burn it in the fire as a fuel. And we can see this because when let's look at the oxidation states. We'll just assign them just one more time using the Lewis structure. Lewis structure for acetic acid looks like this. These two carbons are different, so I'm not going to get the average. Let's go ahead and figure out the individual. And so hydrogen loses, carbon versus carbon's a tie. And so this one comes out to what? So what we do is these two belong, so that's 2, 4, 6, and then half of this, 7. So it ends up with 7 electrons. Does everybody see that?
Yeah.
If it has 7 electrons, it's 3 extra, so it's -3. Now let's look at this carbon. Oxygen loses, and so it ends up with just 1 electron. 1 electron means it's supposed to have 4, it only has 1. It's going to have a deficit, and so it's going to be +3. So this carbon's quite a bit what we say oxidized already. You know, it can only go to +4 and it's maxed out. Mm-hmm. However, this carbon's pretty rich here. And so this will be a fuel. This carbon, good fuel, this carbon's not such a good fuel. This one's already quite a bit oxidized. You can see it's got 2 oxygens already attached to it. See that? And so people eat vinegar. What's the fate of the vinegar after you eat it? Well, you eat vinegar, you inhale oxygen, and eventually you spit out CO2, and you've extracted as much energy from the vinegar as you possibly can because you've completely oxidized it in your body. All right, so this is one of the things we do when we think about chemical properties, you know, and chemical properties, we try to analyze things, but, you know, are chemical properties just redox reactions? No, but if it is a redox reaction, then we want to look at the oxidation state, so review how to do oxidation state here. All right, let's take a break, and then we'll start again. It'll take like a 10-minute break.